She was right back out again in a week. So she's been, I think she's been having some spells, you know, but, so, she was in again.
How are you?
Are you?
Would you like to go by name, Sam?
We are happy to report that any day of the week you meet this, if the student so desires.
Sam Houghton, Madeline.
Hi, Sam. Offering healthy choices
Sam,
every day
this is Barbara
Hamilton. Meal
hi, hi.
Requirements
and this is who?
That dictates the protein
hello.
Sam, are you?
Yeah.
Samantha, right?
No, Teresa. I'll explain it.
Oh.
It's a nickname.
Oh, Sam.
Wonderful to see you. She had the
she has reached out to us
Dr. Campbell's film, and she
and
showed it at East Green Bush Library.
Oh. Interested in
and this is Mr. Zimmer?
School lunches. And, so we'll
and this is Tammy.
Hi.
Hi. And this is Doug.
Yeah, hi.
Nice to meet everybody.
Why don't you have a chair over there next to Madeline? And Madeline will get you some.
I certainly will. Oh, I don't. I already ate. I'm sorry. I eat early. I just thought I'd come by and say hi to everybody, meet everybody, since, you know, I'm saying I'm going
and,
to show up. And
what else have you done that was vegetarian vegan
I think Dr. Campbell
after
to
the East Green Bush film show?
Well, I was over at, oh, what am I doing sitting down? I've been sitting in my car.
I have a short presentation, Dr. Campbell, you come up here.
I'm going to hang around.
This is from the Senate.
I was at the
Dr. T. Colin Campbell, the Senate of
the
State of
Albany Veg Fest this past year. I was there. And now I'm just kind
of
trying to make connections because I'm doing plant-based wellness consulting.
To Hawaii and Mahalo, bringing your message of aloha.
Plant-based wellness consulting.
Yes, I am.
To individuals or corporations?
Individuals, groups, anybody who wants it. I mean, I do one-on-one counseling, and I also do things like, you know, people switch to this kind of way of eating, and they don't really, or they hear about it, and they don't really know what to eat, they don't know how to make it, they don't know how to make it taste good, and so I'll do stuff like, I'll take people shopping, like I'll take them over to Honest Wade or Farmers Markets or whatever, and show them what there is, and talk about what they can do with it, and I will actually go into people's homes or into corporations if they want me, and they haven't yet, but they might. To do like cooking demos, and I'm actually going to be doing a raw apple pie class at Honest Wait Food Co-op in September, and I'm teaching a class on healthy baked goods at Hudson Valley in November.
A raw apple pie.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
As in not cooked.
That sounds good.
Wow.
Well, because I can't eat pastry dough. It doesn't agree with me. I don't really eat a lot of oil, so I eat the pastry dough and my stomach gets really mad. So.
We're going to start our meeting. No more laughing, no more fun. Quite the meeting has begun.
Yeah.
Barbara Hamilton, would you be so kind as to read a little bit of this? It's right there in your magazine and it's on page what, Madeline? What page is that?
That is page 21.
Thank you. Page 21, everybody. And we're going to read about a man named Katz. Thanks, Barb.
Look, Katz has dedicated his life to the science and maintenance, a logic and reason approach to life. He has training in emergency medicine and holistic medicines. Brooke uses food as a healing tool and has become a gourmet chef in order to get the messages across. He authored several cookbooks, including new favorites and made videos. Brooke feeds vegan food to thousands of people every year, absolutely free of charge, because he feels it's one of the best and most dramatic ways of convincing people to listen to the rest of the truth.
Thank you. And what's that other one, Barb? Evan.
Kevin Storm Colfer?
Yes, just a little bit about him.
Is the youngest radio host in New Jersey. He started 6 weeks before his 12th birthday at a small station in southern New Jersey, broadcasting to the Philadelphia area. Now he is at a larger station, WNJE 9-2-0, The Voice, Princeton, on Sundays at noon Eastern. Kevin was born to a veteran mom who is a truck driver. His dad was a chef at the time, but is not a veteran. Kevin has spent a lot of time at protest leafleting and tabling with local groups. He enjoys playing baseball, chess, video games, reading fiction, and hanging out with friends.
Could you read the first two paragraphs about donating to nonprofits?
How are you, Sam?
Do you support causes which you feel are important? Are you a vegan, vegetarian, or vegan curious? Are you interested in compassionate, helpful, sustainable living? Supporting a nonprofit is an opportunity to put your money where your mouth is. Actions speak louder than words. Donating to a cause that is aligned with your beliefs can certainly give you a sense of satisfaction. When you satisfy your hard-earned money, sacrifice your hard-earned money in order to help a bigger cause, you receive a sense of purpose in life, inner satisfaction, and can strengthen your spiritual life.
Oh, thank you. Would you introduce yourself to all of us, friends?
Okay, well, hi, I'm Sandy.
Hi, Sandy.
Yeah.
You know Sandy. Sandy cut her
Sandy,
hair.
Sandy, to your left is Mr. Zimmerman.
Hello, how are you?
Mr. Zimmer.
Zimmer.
Zimmer?
No, man. Zimmerman.
Zimmer.
And you know Doug, don't
yes.
you, Sandy?
Yes,
how are you, Doug?
And this is our new arrival from New Lebanon, Stephenstown, Barbara Hamilton.
Hello.
And this is Tammy, and
hi.
You know Madeline, of course.
Yes. Well,
this is your neighbor.
I know Pat. Now, I just have to tell you,
I'm Sam Marshall.
Sam, hi.
Sandy, you want a bowl to put some
sure.
And I brought some vegan coleslaw with tahini dressing.
I'm going to have to at some point. I didn't have time to make anything, but
okay.
I'll make some raw cookies or something. I mean, I make regular food too. I make non-raw food too, but when it's hot out, you just think, I really don't want to
know about raw cookies.
Raw cookies are easy.
Pat, this is Barbara Hamilton from Steventown.
Hi, Barbara.
Peanut butter and
oatmeal.
And this is
I have a really, really great recipe that's vegan free. Do you know the chocolate covered candy?
No.
Ooh, if you like desserts, chocolate covered candy.
Don't even try desserts.
Chocolate covered candy. It's just like raisins, cocoa powder. Peanut butter and one on your finger or something. And
what
it's
do
like,
we have been here?
It's like,
not one's got Randy.
Well, the fact that you pulled in there with the dates,
sure.
The sweet potato,
mm-hmm.
Here's dates.
Oh, I like dates.
Okay.
Thanks.
I just didn't have time today. I thought I'd just stop.
Okay,
by
well,
and
what you said,
look, I've been saying
what's
for
that?
Like a year.
Oh, boy, look at that.
Yeah, it's all cut.
Here comes the corn lady.
All right.
You're welcome. I'll talk to you soon. Okay, Richard's expecting me, so I don't want to keep coming.
Corn on the
cob. Handicapped parking space.
Thank you.
And pizza. Barbara?
You're welcome.
Slice of pizza?
Wow, all
the
orders.
Is this vegan?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, it was nice and hot.
I don't know what they put
in
it. It was nice and hot.
Even the crust, though?
You don't put egg in crust.
I don't know. I don't make crust, so I don't know.
Here,
you
have corn?
Sure, thank you.
Oh, well, people with paws.
Wow.
How about you?
Sure.
There's
another
plate, right there.
People with hands.
Okay.
I'll hold that one.
Sure. Oh, no, I've eaten. Thank
no,
you.
It's good.
All right. I eat early and I
all
have
thank you.
Bizarre dietary restrictions.
Tammy, do you want a slice of pizza on your plate?
You know what? I'm going to try it. Yes, I am. Thank
all
you.
All right.
Well, you go ahead, take your stuff
actually.
And I'll come back around.
Yeah. Well, I have food
a
lot too, so.
Yeah. Small one.
One bag
for
corn.
I'd love a piece of corn. I don't have a paper plate, but
I can put it in your bowl if that's okay.
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you.
And Tammy actually wants a slice too.
Okay.
Well, thank you, Barbara.
I'll come back. Mr. Zimmer?
Yes, please.
Yes.
What's your first name?
Lee.
Lee. Here, Lee. Whoops, I'm sorry. Go ahead and help yourself.
Okay.
Can you reach it?
Let me see if I can get something under here.
I have a thing in my hand if that's helpful.
See that?
A spatula.
Okay.
I eat a lot of raw too.
I eat more obviously more raw
Sandy?
in the summer, but lately I've been doing more of the like really heavy on the fruit. because I just feel really good that you are.
Barbara, will you read it? Everybody, will you read this?
And I wait an hour, and then I have oatmeal.
See, I just get up and work out.
Barbara's going to read you the last paragraph here.
Sam, pizza, no.
Okay, thank you, I already.
And Tammy, I'm coming back.
The last paragraph.
I'm not to get it on myself, I got it all.
Sandy, it's page 21.
Okay.
Encourage more donors?
No, right down here, the last paragraph.
Right here?
No, right here.
Okay, great.
I had help with stuff.
All right. Consider,
brag about the charities you like on social media, invite your friends and family.
Oh, okay.
Invest in the charities. Consider donating today, you'll be glad you did.
Okay, thank you.
Pandora pizza?
Yes, please.
You want to wait until you're done, or let me tell you have room?
Which one? I want a little one, is that one?
I'm supposed to be careful if people are passing the food around, because I went to Vegetarian Summer Fest this year, and I'm usually I usually am pretty controlled about how I eat, and then when you're there, now, forget it. You pay for it, you just, that's my once a year where I just kind of.
Where? Get your small one.
Johnstown has a pretty.
Oh, fun.
Lou, will you go to the next page and read three paragraphs from that, please?
Page 22.
Yes, dear.
Vegan dining event, June 14th,
2015.
Do you imagine dining with friends in any restaurant and being able to enjoy a satisfying meal that is all vegan? Make the change you want. Consider using ideas from the American Vegan Society. Our own Freda Dinja happened into a Mediterranean restaurant which serves typical meat and cheese containing meals. She engaged in a brief, unplanned discussion with proprietor Michael D. Domenico. As a result of the conversation, Michael will be creating a vegan event on Sunday, June 14th, 2015, with a choice of seating for lunch at 1 p.m. or dinner at 6. An admitted stranger to making vegan entrees, Michael said he is looking forward to creating new, gratifying dishes as he explores alternatives for meat and dairy. Seven of us attended his tasting dinner in preparation for the upcoming fair. The meal was wonderful with the right mix of textures, colors, flavors, and spices to provide. My dining partner shared his name. Simon Kim, an intern at AVS who was learning about vegan food and the vegan ideology, said it brought my experience of vegan cuisine to a whole new level. The food was superb. AVS volunteer Alicia. Do you want this seat?
No, you're fine. Sit right there.
That's enough, and thank you very much.
Hello.
Hi.
Can we help our new arrivals to the vegan casserole?
Absolutely.
Yes. Do we have
right over here? We have more dishes.
One on the
dishes.
Bob, yeah. And vegan pizza.
Go over there and get that one.
Yeah, we
here's another vegan pizza.
There's a chair right
there. A chair with a cooler on it. It certainly doesn't need that cooler on it.
Wow.
This is the casserole.
Yeah. And there's another one just like here.
The dish. Let me get you two.
How many people use oil as a high cook?
As what?
Oil. How many people use oil in what they cook?
I do oil.
I'm just wondering because I would like to eat with you guys sometime, but I don't eat oil. It makes me very
So that has two different kinds too.
I have to kind of assess what you guys are eating tonight, and then maybe one time I'll be in.
What do you use then?
I just don't.
I just don't.
If I'm baking, I'll use applesauce. My one caveat is I have yet to find
chair
a oil-free cookie that actually works. So I will eat oil in like a cookie. When I was at Summerfest, I unwittingly
have some vegan
coconut oil in it, and it was good. But I was sick all night. Like I felt really heavy. And
Tony, do you want some?
You know, so.
There's small plates over here.
Yeah,
and Gary,
have you tried the hemp seed oil?
Let me put two together.
Of course, hemp seed oil.
Till my wife died, and then you know I stopped going.
Oh, it's still worth it.
Yeah, well,
Mark's food.
It's an 8-hour drive from
I
where I live, so you know I would have to drive all by myself.
I'd like to introduce you to the Holton family.
Yeah.
Okay. Holton family. Holton family. Announce yourselves to all of your friends here.
I'm Debbie Holden. I'm Mrs.
I'm Sally Holden.
Hi. And over there?
I'm Gary.
Holden, H-O-L-T-O-N.
No, H-O-L-D-E-N.
Oh, H-O-L-D-E-N, sorry. And this is Tony Orlando.
Ostringer.
And Ostringer.
Where's Dawn?
Where's Dawn?
And now, folks, would you go around the table and say your names for the Holtons and for Tony Ostringer?
I'm Lee Zimmer.
Barbara Hamilton.
Oh, there.
Lou Kosarski. Kowalski.
Yeah. It's often mispronounced.
Karwalski.
Karwaski.
Karwaski. And then the Holtons, the two Holtons, and Douglas.
Yeah,
you all know Douglas.
We brought Tammy.
Holtons and Tony.
Tammy.
Douglas, right?
Tammy's in the middle.
Tammy's here, you forgot
him. And then Mr. Zimmer, the architect, do you know him?
I don't think so. Hello.
He was here the one time over here. And this is Sandy.
I'm Sandy.
And Sam. Mm-hmm. Sandy and Sam.
Sandy, what's your last name?
Sandy Blakeman.
Sandy Blakeman. And next to her is Sam Holton. And Sam does extensive vegetarian work. And of course, Madeline. Madeline Chapin?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm not sure I'd say extensive, but I'd say I'm trying to extend.
Tammy, would you read us the next page, please? Two or three paragraphs, whatever you choose.
Do you need a fork?
I didn't get a fork.
Did your mom help those for some forks?
She's got them up in a box right behind her.
Compassionate man bites into the meat market. Beyond Meat is now making great strides towards the company's 25-20 vision of creating a 25% global reduction of animal meat consumption by the year 2020. This lofty goal, has stated on the company website, would do wonders for human health, for the environment, for conservation of natural resources, and for animals. Watching Ethan Brown being interviewed on mainstream media such as the Today Show, one is struck by how carefully he chooses words such as plant meat for his product. This vegan understands how to meet people where they are and help them step forward. He's aiming products at the mass market. 70 million Americans are already reducing meat consumption, and he's hoping to reach further. He provides real meat made from 100% plant protein in over 7,000 U.S. retail outlets.
Thanks, Tammy.
You're That's
welcome.
Funny. I just heard this guy. Does anybody listen to the Rich Roll podcast? Mm-hmm. Oh, I just heard. I was been listening to the Rich Roll podcast, and I just listened to this episode with where he interviewed this guy from Beyond Meat. And this is interesting what they're doing.
Folks, this corn is exquisite. Tammy and I went way out in the country and got
it's
it.
In that red corn.
And, and he just brought it into the stand. Isn't it terrific?
Did you go to the place I told you about?
No, we went to a place that. We were going to that place and we saw this sign. And it said 1 mile down Bunker Hill Road.
Oh, okay.
And he just brought it in from the field. Isn't it terrific?
Wow.
I
don't get any fresher than that.
What about these vegan t-shirts? Should we get these vegan t-shirts, Sam?
Well, if they're unisex, I can't wear them. I look like a sack in unisex shirts. But if other people would like to wear them.
What do you think, folks? How many say aye?
Aye.
Aye.
How many say nay? Motion's carried. Now, what page are we on now, folks?
26.
26 and 27. 27.
This one right here?
Yeah, we were on 26, yeah.
I think this is where she was just reading.
Oh, it wasn't that.
I thought we did that one.
Okay,
about 27.
A bit of paper towel.
This one right here? We did that one. Did we do this one, Tammy?
I was on page 26, the left-hand column.
Okay. Douglas, where are you, dear?
Yeah, here.
Okay, will you read us some of the next page?
You said on the next page. That's the page 27?
This page? Is this the page we're on, folks?
No.
No.
We need to go back a page, I think.
That's 20, it's
25.
Okay, 27, Doug.
Yeah, all right. All right, why don't I start? You want me to start at the top?
Just pick up, yeah, and two paragraphs is enough.
All right. The one that starts at human health sounds very important. Human health. It seems that every year, or even more frequently, a major university or research institution comes out with a study that somehow implicates animal protein in a major disease. Yet one of my favorites on that subject is the 7th edition of an American classic, Baby and Child Care, one of the best-selling books of all time, at 50 million copies. Dr. Benjamin Spock first wrote The Common Sense Guide to Baby and Child Care in 1946, and by the 7th edition, 1991, he advocates a preference for feeding children vegan foods. I find this interesting because it was largely ignored in everyday practice despite the broader popularity of his work, an indicator that our protein choices run much deeper than their associated dietary complications.
Thank you.
All right.
Debbie Holden, would you read us something on page 28?
I would love to.
Next page.
Where were you, honey?
28. Watch. Next page.
Anything I'm
talking about. Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to start with 10 tips. I'll do the first couple and then I'll pass it to Gary to do some more. I don't know what the. Create a monthly vegan potluck in your community. Oh, this is what you had in your.
What page are you on?
28. As told. Okay, secure a location that provides tables, chairs. It may also have a counter space and a sink. Many public libraries, community centers, schools, or churches have free meeting rooms that are perfect. Grocery stores with a deli dining area may be interested in hosting. It's great for their business. People just show up and buy hummus on the spot. Tip number two, free advertising is your friend. Send press releases to local papers, websites, and the Chamber of Commerce calendar. Create a Facebook page for your group and events. Put up posters in coffee shops, health food stores, and funky shops. Start an email invitation list and use a free service like MailChimp for easy professional-looking e-bites. Use Potluck on happycow.net. Use meetup.com to advertise and find new members. Free for members, but there is an annual fee for hosting.
And tip good enough. And daughters, Holden, will you read us on the next page?
Great.
On the next page, or keep going with the 10 tips?
What am I doing?
Keep going with the 10 tips.
Okay.
Tips.
Okay.
So, number three now?
Mm-hmm.
Create a potluck checklist. Napkins, cups, plates, serving spoons, extension cords, tablecloths, sign-up sheets, pen and paper so folks can share recipes and write up their ingredients lists. And name tags. We provide dishes, utensils, hot plates, and extra serving bowls, all donated or purchased at thrift shops. Number four, have a theme. It gives people a chance to be creative, such as Richard Nixon's birthday, the Mother's Day Nutritional Yeast Fest, National Pecan Month, the Roswell Incident, had silly posters, some people dressed like aliens. Are you a good witch or a sandwich? Black and white party. The Easter Sunday, what a friend we have in cheeses. All non-dairy, of course. Oktoberfest. Five, let people know they do not have to cook. Newbies can bring something to drink or something simple like salsa. Number six, require a list of ingredients. This is helpful for those who have food allergies and a charm for weeding out any accidental non-vegan dishes. Discreetly explain to the person how to bring it vegan next time.
Oh boy, I'm gonna not do that when I head up my trick potluck in October.
What was it, me?
Number seven, you're
number right. Seven, eh? Okay. I guess we're still talking about potlucks, right?
Yes.
Make it fun and educational. Decorate with colourful, informative posters. Provide free literature, such as from PCRM or Vegan Outreach. Share your personal library. If your house is overflowing with cookbooks and documentaries, why not share them? Do a 5-minute recipe demo while waiting for latecomers. Show a short video, upbeat and informative. Have an after-dinner presentation. Number eight, Realize that your potluck may attract homeless, hungry people, and this is a tough situation. You don't want to scare off new attendees, and you want to show compassion to everyone. We never turn people away, but some groups charge a small fee to attend. Leave the this is number 9 now, by the way.
Yeah.
Leave the location cleaner than it was when you arrived. And finally, number 10, meet amazing people with so many reasons to explore a plant-based diet. You will meet animal lovers, raw foodies, environmentalists, and good-hearted people of all ages. Hear, hear.
That's right.
Is that all 10?
That's all 10.
Thank you, Mr. Holt.
Does anybody want any corn?
Yes, please. Corn,
the corn's fantastic, by the way.
Yeah,
it's unbelievable.
Another. Yes, it was good.
Mr. Zimmer.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
What do you want to read next?
The next page, two paragraphs.
You know what?
Global population, the vegan issue.
There you go.
The vegan movement turned 70 last November.
70?
The early...
Wow. Did you know it was that old?
The early vegans noted that 2 billion humans were overwhelming a small planet. Fast forward to today, our human population is more than 7 billion. This is not about misanthropy, nor about judging parents. Where would we be without them? But a good look inward on the part of humanity is past due. It's an issue for all of us. People in affluent societies, vegans included, use an especially large share of the planet's natural resources. Notably, of all species recorded as becoming extinct since the year 1500, the largest number of erased species lived in the current territory of the United States, followed by the United Republic of Tanzania, Uganda, and Mauritius, whatever that is. You want me to continue?
No, that's good. Thanks. And Sandy Blakeman?
Many of our customs compromise animals' individual dignity and the integrity of their communities and habitat. There's the classification of free-living animals as game. There's our habit of moving animals from place to place and then adding insult to injury by calling them invasive. In humanity's brief history on Earth, we have played the bully's role, inventing traps and poisons and mass eradication plans, even deploying air forces against other animals. We're currently testing and imposing fertility control on communities of free animals throughout the world, and insisting that this is for their own good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Big Sam.
Yeah.
Yo.
Big Sam, where are you? 30, I believe.
Are we moving on here?
Through it all?
Yeah. Now, are we moving on to the next page here?
Yeah.
Up on the Plantier Nation 23 City Tour. Anybody seen this movie?
I'll try that.
I saw it at Summerfest, but I wasn't really paying attention. Plantier Nation? I saw it at Summerfest, but I wasn't really paying attention. I was thinking about something else. I got into this conversation before the screening and just... But I'll see it again. Dr. T. Colin Campbell, I'm going to start with the second one. Actor D. Colin Campbell, best-selling author of The China Study, and his son, director Nelson Campbell, have teamed up in Plantier Nation. The forthcoming film examines the political and economic factors that suppress information on the benefits of plant-based nutrition, while making the connections of this idea to larger issues such as medical practice, farming, and food deserts. The production team will recruit Plantier Nation ambassadors in each city to help build local interest in viewing the official release of the film, which is scheduled for the week of July 4th in 23 cities. I look forward to traveling this country with my dad, bringing to people the health message he has spent his life researching, and I'm proud to be joined by our talented film team, said Nelson Campbell. I'm gratified to see the grassroots interest building around the science of plant-based nutrition, but unfortunately, many powerful interests continue to oppose this idea, added Dr. Campbell.
Wonderful. Now tell them about the Dr. Campbell video that you showed at the East Green.
Oh, has anybody seen Forks Over Knives?
Yeah.
I, a while back, I got a chance to actually get permission to do a screening of that, and that, you know, that requires all sorts of rigmarole. But we did that, and that was a lot of fun, and that's one of my favorites because I think it really
brings home the fact that the reason we're all sick, you know, as a nation and as a world now, is we're eating too much processed garbage and too many animal products. And it's switching to the plant-based diet really is what helps a lot of people. There's great anecdotal stories in there, and there's science in there, and it's one of my favorites.
How many people did
you
get?
That's where I met Sam.
I think about 15.
And that was 2 years ago, and I called her up, and she just returned my call tonight.
Yeah, I've been saying I'm going to show up, and I finally
just very busy.
I'm just kind of a hermit. It's hard to get me out of the house.
Got
to
call you more than once, huh?
I'm going to tell you folks what this next one is about. Could you read the headline, please? And I'll tell you what it's about.
The emotional lives of animals and children.
Yeah. You know what it's about, and I think you will all agree to this, how children love animals. Mm-hmm. Yeah. They just love every animal. Mm-hmm. And then they have to be taught not to love them. And that's what this book is all about. Just read a little paragraph there, could you, Mama?
Anywhere?
No, the top of the...
Oh, the surprise and delight of a child meeting an animal at a farmed animal sanctuary reveals the evolutionary bond of kinship between humans and other animals through the lenses of these innocent but not childish encounters. That children are enchanted by a chicken, a turkey, or a pig at a sanctuary and the reciprocity okay, that springs between them shows that our interspecies connections go far beyond just keeping a pet. This prospect is explored with significant implications by William Crane in his new book. Bill and Ellen Crane founded Safe Haven Farm Sanctuary in Dutchess County, New York in 2008. Bill, a psychology professor at the City College of New York, and Ellen, a pediatrician in a large public hospital, purchased and renovated a broken-down farm with pasture. Bill describes his and Ellen's evolution through their busy professional lives towards a growing concern for animals.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Anybody want any more corn? We'll pass it around, okay?
Corn's awesome.
Huh? It was delicious.
Does anybody know where this is?
And how about some more pizza? Let's pass around the pizza.
Tony, do you know where that is?
No, I don't.
Well, if it's in
Dutchess County, that's down south a little bit, right?
Yeah. Mark, can you pass it on the pizza?
Well, you know what?
I can get that right now.
Let's have, see if, I may not have enough from that here in Nassau, but I'll see if my Safari will
just pass it down.
I wonder if they have what?
I have so much to get out of there.
I'm going to have another face for that. Lee, are you having another face, Matt?
No, I'm not.
Why not, huh?
Here, have a plate.
Thank you, Tommy.
You're welcome.
Yeah, man, I'll go with you serve you.
As long as he's serving.
There you go. Are you ready, Doug?
Yes. Are you having more?
Oh, no, thank you.
All right.
There you go, Doug.
Yeah, thanks. It's plenty. Just the water, please. I don't have to reach over in front of you.
Wow.
How about?
Yeah. That's plenty.
Thank you,
yes. Right, we almost polished it off.
Mr. Tony's going to read
the next page.
The next page.
Thank you. Through there.
Sure. Thank you, dear.
She wanted you to have more corn.
So who did?
Another piece of pizza?
Yeah, I can't do anymore.
No. No, me neither.
I've got a sparse pizza here.
Sure.
Can you pass me that water, Sal, when you're ready, bud?
That would definitely be a disaster. I've been off. I'm beginning to suspect I may have a minor gluten sensitivity. I haven't tested bread yet, so I definitely don't want to do this.
Thanks, Tommy.
Okay, Corey, what do you want to read you? Next page?
Thank you.
There you go.
Their first rescued animal was a hen, then several goats, sheep, and chickens, about whom Bill writes insightfully with feeling. He says of 19 deep mutilated hens who were cared for by a homeless man in Paris, and their ability and anger crushing the early days of their arrival at the Safe Haven transformed into happy contentment only after they could forage outdoors as they please. It isn't just freedom, space alone, that matters to animals. Crane says of the hen's transformation, but freedom to engage in natural behavior that leads to deep contentment. The key question posed by the emotional lives of animals and children is what happens between childhood and adulthood that causes most children to outgrow their primal delight in and empathy with animals and become detached, callous, and indifferent toward them. Tragically, for animals and most people, a shadow, an iron curtain falls between the child and the adult who share the same body and for some, presumably, the same psyche. And while this severance is marked, its causes and cures are not clear. How can children's love for animals be nurtured into adult values and public policies? Crain writes, for animal defenders, the childhood attitudes offer encouragement. They indicate that a strong affinity to animals is part of our natural existence before the socialization process disrupts it.
Yeah, I believe that, don't you?
Oh, yeah. It is a basic resource we can try to regain. The stories of the sanctuary animals, their lives, their friendliness and fears, their eagerness and intelligence are all the more potent against background misery from which they emerge to tell us something about themselves through the voice of an adult whose own story of personal awakening holds promise.
Thank you, Julian.
Yep.
This is vegan ice cream here. I'm going to pass it down, Sam. We'll pass it down. And there's also popsicles. And here's the scissors to open the popsicles.
That was,
We could use these first.
Barbara Hamilton, will you tell us about new books?
Yes. Okay, we have Melissa Owen and Fudge.
These are for ice cream.
There's a big spoon right at the end of the table where Glendora is. I don't know.
Sea Shepherd's Anti-Whale Campaign.
Yes, please.
How to Eat a Rainbow. Magical raw vegan recipes for kids.
Oh my goodness, they made cookie dough.
The New Chicago Diner Cookbook. Meat free recipes from America's Veggie Diner.
Oh, wow. Okay, thanks.
Here's
one. And now, there are veggie fests all over the United States from Oregon to Boston. Every month of the year, Veggie Fest, all over. So if you're traveling, you can look up a Veggie Fest by going to the American Vegan Society magazine. The next page, folks,
chocolate.
Is what? Let's see, this is Lou. Lou, you see this right here?
What's the page?
This would be, what page, ma'am?
33. Okay.
And it's this part right here, if you would read it, Lou.
Okay. vegans, it's pronounced vegans. not vegans. Okay, pronounced vegans. Eat solely from the plant kingdom, vegetables, fruits, legumes, grains, nuts, and seeds. Vegans express nonviolence toward animals and the earth. AVS promotes good health practices and harmonious living. Vegans exclude flesh, fish, fowl, dairy products, eggs, honey, and all other items of animal origin. Vegans do not use animal products such as leather, wool, fur, silk, animal oils, secretions, etc., in clothes and commodities. Now vegetarians, they use no flesh, fish, fowl, and other products of slaughter such as gelatin and animal broths. Still using dairy products, which is lacto-vegetarian, or eggs, which is ovo-vegetarian. Anything else on that page?
No, that's it, and thank you. Now, we're on the next to the last page. There's going to be a moon glow party. It's all vegan. And it is in September 27th. Do we want to hire a bus and go?
Where is it, Glendora?
It's in Vineland, New Jersey.
New Jersey.
Oh, you know, I heard about that.
Yeah.
When I went to the animal rights thing, I was talking about it.
Are you getting out with that?
Yeah. Yeah. This man here, he's a weightlifter.
3 hours.
He's a weightlifter.
Is that is that the vegan bodybuilder?
You're wearing the same shirt.
No. And he says, I'm strong not because of the weights I lift, but because of the things that I stand up for, not eating animals. That completes the American Vegan Magazine. Now, Holton Donna, will you please tell us what you made us, that beautiful dessert that we're going to pass around, and it's so warm?
It is,
stand up, honey.
We're gonna teach her.
It is plum and pear. It's kind of like crumble, but not crumbly. And the plums are fresh from our neighbor's garden.
Oh, nice.
Oh, good.
There's no butter in it.
No oil. No oil, Sam.
I can't eat anything else right now, thank you. I was just explaining. I have a minor digestive condition, and if I eat at times that are outside of when I normally eat, I can get very ill. So I'm not eating your food to be offensive. It's just that I'm trying to work with healing my body. But I will definitely kind of get a feel of what you guys serve and try to accommodate and actually eat with you guys sometime, because that sounds lovely. Well, I mean, I've been eating stone fruits. Like, it's amazing I haven't turned into a peach right now. Because I work over at Honest Wait on Friday nights, and I work in the produce department, and I came home with a box of peaches so big that it actually popped the shelf out of the lower part of my refrigerator. I'm trying to open doors tonight, and I can't. I couldn't figure out what's going on. But
I'll have a little bit.
Houghton daughter, would you please read this article from the Advertiser.
What is your first name?
Sally.
Thank you, Dave.
Hold on, I want to get you
those
crumbs.
Should I stand up? Or?
No, you can sit down.
Okay. The Glendora Vegetarian Club. William Crane wrote a book about the surprise and delight of a child meeting an animal farm sanctuary. It reveals the evolutionary bond, he says, between humans and other animals. Children are enchanted by a chicken, a turkey, or a pig at a sanctuary.
Okay, that's enough. We went through that. Thank you. And, Mommy, can you read the next Advertiser article?
Mommy is serving the dessert, but
right.
It looks
okay.
Amazing. Yeah.
She's got a far more important job. And she's doing a good job. That's what we should do, is go around and serve each other.
This one?
Tammy, will you read the next Advertiser?
There's some chocolate here, too.
I certainly will.
And it's too hot.
This is delicious, Sally.
Thank you.
Yeah. It's very good.
Sounds
amazing.
Yeah.
Now, is there
Tammy, could you read the next one?
No, I'm working on it. It goes to August 20th.
Oh, that's delicious.
Is it good?
Okay, August 20th.
What is it like this?
The Glendora Vegetarian Club. Like Bonnie Goodman in Livingston, Montana, you can start a live and let live grow in your hometown. She writes, the intention of our potluck is to demystify veganism and share delicious food and easy recipes with people who are open-minded and veg-curious. Everyone is welcome in Live and Let Live events. Our slogan is, you do not have to be vegan, but the food does. When we make the change for the love of animals, the environment, social justice, or your health, begin vegan is such a thrill, said Bonnie. But it can be lonely. The desire to share this amazing lifestyle may not be met by friends nor family. Starting neighborhood potluck in your hometown is an exciting way to find like-minded people and make new friends while educating the public. Join us on Wednesday, August 26th, the last Wednesday of the month at 6 p.m. for more good food at the Nassau Free Library. That's tonight.
Do you like our articles in the Advertiser?
Yeah, that's
I like them.
That's great.
Yeah,
I always like that you put a blurb to it.
It's
not just like come to our club. It's always some interesting information.
That's the next one.
I have to send them blurbs on my classes soon. I gotta tell you, I love this picture. I'm aspiring to that right there.
Yeah, that's a good.
I don't have a squat rack though.
I love your dessert, sir.
I don't have a squat rack.
I like the consistency and the taste.
Glendora's
Yes, very good.
Can you read us an article from the Advertiser?
Videos on
them.
I'm sorry, I didn't see the video, but I didn't
either. All right, this one goes back to 8/13/15. It says the Glendora Vegetarian Club. This is it. Right, this is the next one, right?
Yep.
What does a report card teach a parent? You do not have to lift weights to raise a dumbbell.
Read it again, Doug.
You do not have to lift weights to raise a dumbbell. Muscular weightlifter Ben Burho says, I'm a strong man not because of the weight I lift in the gym, but because of the lives I stand up for on a daily basis. He
That's
is
okay,
vegan.
Doug, we covered that, thanks.
Yeah.
Can you go on to the next one?
All right.
That's worth covering again.
Okay. Some of them are handwritten notes. I think this is maybe what you submitted. That's it on those. The others are your handwritten notes.
Do they say Glendora Vegetarian Club anywhere? Okay, on the next one, Doug.
Well, that's it.
Okay. Then.
You got notes.
What is this, everybody?
Ray. The Complete Idiot's Guide to Vegan Living.
Oh.
I don't appreciate being called an idiot.
It's for people like me that are new.
There's a whole series, though, right?
Yeah.
Idiot's Guide to Everything.
I know, I don't like that.
I know, they're doing this for the computer things, too. Dummy 101 for dummies.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's very difficult, though.
I refuse to buy it.
You all see expensive. This gentleman?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
This gentleman is the man
Hi,
who
Franklin.
You have to thank for all of our...
Thank you, Franklin.
Yes,
thank
this
you.
Is all of our... joy and food that we have at the Glendora Vegetarian Club.
Oh.
He sends some money down from heaven.
Thank you.
We were married 48 years.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he left his body in 2003.
Franklin has a lovely smile.
Yes, you'd love him and he would love you.
What did he do?
He was a newspaper reporter for the Buffalo Evening News, general assignment. This is one more reading. I'm wondering if Sandy Blakeman, while the Holdens tell us about England and their lovely vacation, they sent us a card.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they sent us a card. And Sandy Blakeman, would you pick out a page to this to read after the Holdens finish their report?
Sure.
Can I just say that I really appreciate your jokes on your answering machine?
Good, right? I have a wonderful joke for you tonight.
Oh, good.
So, Holtons, tell us about England.
Come on, Sally.
As you can tell from my dad's accent, he was born and raised there. So, we go and live with my grandparents for... approximately 6 weeks every year in the summer. And we also do lots of day trips and, you know, a few days here and there at my dad's friend's house and cousins and such. We went to Cornwall, which is the southern part, where we spent about a week with my dad's cousin.
What did you do while you were there, Sally?
Well, I went cliff jumping with my brother.
Really?
Wow.
And
oh
who
goodness.
Led the charge in his underwear? My father.
Cliff jumping in your underwear.
Who's in sure. trouble for having done that?
No, no reason no for the underwear. That's what I don't understand.
He just had no shorts at the time. He didn't think about it.
What's involved with cliff jumping? It sounds dangerous.
Like from the top, you'd...
Into water?
And
No,
jump. Into water. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that's why you're in your room. Yeah. I get it.
So you know, one of the things, there's being in England, it's as far as being vegetarian or vegan's concerned, you know, there's good things and bad things. There always seems to be great choices when you eat out because there's lots of ethnic restaurants. So there's you know, there's Indian, there's Pakistani, there's Bangladesh, there's Mediterranean, and a lot of those cultures have a strong vegetarian tradition. So it's pretty easy. Even and supermarkets are good too. In fact, there's a whole range of vegetarian food that for some reason we don't see on this side of the Atlantic, and that's Linda McCartney, you know, Paul McCartney's wife.
Yeah.
She was a lifelong vegetarian. I think she was a lifelong vegetarian. And you know, she's got a whole range of food, but for some reason it didn't make it over here. Mm. Or it hasn't made it over here yet.
Yeah,
but
you can buy their food over here. I think so. I think I've seen it.
Yeah.
No.
I don't think so.
For some reason that you couldn't.
So that was that, and then what else? Oh, we went to London for a few days, didn't we?
Yeah, we saw the play.
And again.
We saw Big Ben.
Yeah, and again, you know, you can always find places to eat and things to eat.
We went on the London Eye and we saw the Kinks play Sunny Afternoon. We were right there. In fact, Gary got hit by a piece of paper.
Anybody remember the 60s?
I don't remember them, but I was always a fan.
Yeah, right, yeah. Remember, you know the Kinks?
Oh yeah.
The British Invasion.
Yeah.
Well, Ray Davies wrote a musical about his early days in the group and growing up in London. And, you know, it's being performed in the Harold Pinter Theatre, so we got to see it, and it was a real fantastic show.
Well, we did think of you at the end of July.
Well, we must have been thinking of it because we sent a postcard, right?
Yeah.
Thank you so much. Oh, it was wonderful. I was thrilled with it. Thank you.
How long were you over there? 2 weeks? 3 weeks?
Six weeks.
Oh, wow.
We always go from the beginning of July to the middle of August.
Nice. Yeah. You see what elite people we have coming to the vegetarian?
Well traveled.
We are international.
Some of us are.
Sandy, you want to read a powerful vegan thoughts? This book was written by Jay, who was the founder of the American Vegan Society.
Okay, let's see.
Vegans look upon the earth as a great source of food, shelter, and clothing for humanity, as well as a provider of sustenance for the animal and plant kingdoms. In regard to feeding the planet's growing human population, a vegetarian diet is several times as efficient as meat production in terms of acreage and water used for growing it. But vegan fare similarly exceeds the lacto-ovo-vegetarian diet in production efficiency. As in every reason for basic vegetarianism, veganism lays claim to the same reason and compounds it. And then it goes
Thank you,
more.
Sandy.
Yeah.
That reminds me, has anyone seen the film Cowspiracy?
No, but I want
to.
Fabulous film. Fabulous film. All about sustainability and that exact sort of thing.
Have you seen the video Eating? Eating, E-A-T-I-N-G, eating.
I haven't seen that one yet.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
It lists all the illnesses from A to Z, and how a vegan diet can have a great impact on all of these diseases.
Recent book, honey? Is it?
No, it's been out for about, I'd say maybe 3-4 years or so.
Yeah, I've heard of it, I just haven't seen that one yet. I'll have to
how many
have
here
have
Excuse
you
me?
Seen Unity?
No.
Because that's playing at the Spectrum September 14th
and
September 11th. It's also playing at the Madison
Theater. What is it?
I'm not sure. I haven't seen it yet.
Well,
so
I'm asking, and I have an iPhone, so I might as well.
It's supposed to be something about like our choices that we're making, how it's affected the planet and everything.
Oops.
How many here are vegan? Well, keep it up, please. One. Sam? Two.
Yeah, that's me. I just need my other finger.
Four and five. How many here are vegetarians?
Oh, I guess we got rid of that.
Oh, good.
How many here are flexitarians? That's a real term, by the way.
Wait a minute. Yeah, is that when you're doing like yoga moves while you're eating?
Tell me about your progress becoming a vegan or a vegetarian, anybody? Anybody make any progress? Anybody make any progress this
I'm making
week?
Progress.
Oh, good.
Well done, Matt.
What did you do for the cause, anybody, this week?
Well, I took up the October potluck at my church. Everyone shakes turns heading it up, and I never have because everyone knows I'm vegan, and everyone knows I'm seriously plant-based, and I'm pretty serious about it. And fortunately, a friend of mine who happens to be a deaconess and our church treasurer recently got more into the plant-based thing, and she's got my back. So October's our plant-based potluck.
Well, what church is that, Sam?
Lake Avenue Community Church in Averill Park.
Get out of
town. What do you want to do next month, anybody? Got any ideas for next month? Barbara Hamilton, any ideas?
When's the movie?
We're going to see
September 11th, it's at the Madison, and September 14th, it's at the Spectrum.
Repeat.
Unity. It's a movie.
I'm teaching
Repeat
a raw
the
pie
date.
Class. Well,
September
11th. Next month. So,
Sam, this potluck, right? 14th. That's home to all the community, right?
It's our post church potluck, really, for our church. But if people want to bring friends and like come to our church and come to the potluck. You're welcome to,
right.
to see.
Everyone is to take home a copy of the American Vegan Society magazine. We finished reading it, and here's your joke for the week. Are you ready?
Oh, I'm ready.
This minister got new teeth. Got new teeth. And his first, what is it, Madeline?
No, excuse me. I'm just looking for the spoon.
You need a serving spoon?
It's okay. Go ahead, Glendora.
And his first sermon was only 10 minutes long after he got the new teeth. His first sermon was only 10 minutes long. And his second sermon was 15 minutes long. And his third sermon was 2 hours long. Why? Well, when I got the new teeth, it hurt, and so I cut it short. And by the time I got the second sermon, I felt better, so I let it go regular. And the third sermon, I made a mistake. I put into my mouth my wife's teeth.
Yeah.
You got it?
Yeah.
I've got to leave, but it's been great meeting the new people.
Bye, Doug.
Always great as always.
Bye, Doug.
Nice to see you,
Doug. Thank you for the catnip.
You're welcome. Yeah.
You're going to Seventh Day Saturday?
Yeah, I'm going to try to go.
Okay.
Yeah. I've got to get ready for a market.
We have a prayer, time for prayer. Do you have anybody that you want us to pray for?
All
right.
See you later.
See you, Doug.
Please, I need the...
Like Cat's continued recovery.
Cat's continued. What's her name?
Muffin Man.
What's going on with your cat?
She recently had a tail amputation.
Oh, dear.
Wow.
Yikes.
Write it down out
the... They originally thought they were only going to have to take half of the tail. But they ended up taking most of the whole tail. She's only got like this much.
Nice. What, was the tail infected, or why'd they have to take the tail off?
It did become infected. It started pressing up on food, but yeah. So then they just decided that it was best done, and they were worried that she might be incontinent and not be able to go to the bathroom at all. And she's only a year old.
Wow.
You know, it's a he. We call her she. I'm sorry. The gender thing going on there. But we have two cats. One's they're both boys. Stud Muffin and Muffin Man. So we got them like that. But Stud Muffin knows that, you know, we call Muffin Man
his popular
sister.
Cat.
Yeah. But,
I think
so,
Muffin.
Right? So anyway.
Right over there.
Okay, so she came home, and the first thing that she did was run into the bathroom, went into the kitty litter, and was able to successfully evacuate her bladder.
Good.
So we were all happy. Everybody was happy. The next day she was able to take care of the number two business as well.
Wow.
So she's doing really well. But I just don't want anything to go back, you know, with her having any issues. She's on a natural herb called saw palmetto.
Oh yeah,
to help
heard
with
of that.
To help with that. So we're trying to keep it a little natural with her, you know. So that's what we're. You know,
what's her name?
Muffin Man.
Muffin Man.
They're two brothers.
Okay.
We thought that Muffin was a girl.
Okay.
And Stud. We gave things once.
Yeah. So it just kind of stuck.
Yeah.
Did you all have ginger snaps? Did you all have cupcakes? There's cupcakes and ginger snaps. Pass it around, folks. Well, it's time for our theme song. Anybody going to join me?
Yeah, you start us off and then...
Start us
all
off.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your hearts and let us sing. Just be kind, stop the cruel. Thou cows and pigs, leave them alone. The horses, hens and turkeys too, save the fish. Just be kind. One with God. One with God, hallelujah.
We need the words.
We need
the words, Glendora.
We need to print them on a card so we can sing them with you.
Yeah. Okay, good idea.
Yeah.
Sure. And you promised to do that?
Yeah.
All right.
Give us the words.
Yeah, we'll have to get the words first of all, Glendora.
We have spent, as of this morning, 392 hours on the Glendora Vegetarian Club. I would say today we put in about 10 hours.
Wow.
And I would say today we spent at least $200, haven't we? $35 for the casserole, right?
Mm-hmm.
The pizzas are 20 each.
Wow.
So we spent about $100. So that brings the total up to...
How about the ice cream?
Oh, yeah, ice cream's what? How much was yours?
It was 27.
27?
Yeah.
So listen, that brings the total, not counting today, up to $3,631.
Yeah, cookie dough.
Now, as I say, that's financed by our dear Franklin.
Thank you, Franklin.
Thank you, Franklin. Last year at this time, we had 17 people. And we have three new people. Today, we have 13. I think that's a nice number, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Frankly, don't you?
Yeah.
I don't like great big groups.
Well, we've been around the table while.
That's true.
Yeah,
it's family style. What do you say? How many say they like the little numbers we have?
Yeah.
Yes, he's almost unanimous. Sam, what do you say?
Well, having it been my first time here, I think it's very comfortable.
Okay.
It's very comfortable group size.
Now.
But we wouldn't turn anyone away.
Exactly.
I want Tony to tell you what he does. He does a wonderful thing with the animal hotline.
Oh.
Stand up, please, Tony.
There's an organization called North Country Wild Care that I occasionally volunteer with. It's usually two times a month. Basically, it's a collection of people that are wildlife rehabbers that assist orphaned and injured animals. If they're orphaned, they take care of them, they raise them until they're old enough to be released into the wild. If they're injured, you know, they assess the injuries and, you know, help them heal and then eventually release them back out into the wild. The goal is to be able to release the animals into the wild. What I do, because I don't do the rehab in part, because it's very time consuming, especially when you have orphan animals, orphan babies that you're dealing with, I work the hotline. So the hotline, during baby season, is quite busy. There's usually over, during the month of like May, June into July, there's usually at least 100 calls a day.
Wow.
Each one of those calls is somebody calling about an animal that's, you know, like a baby that's been thrown from the nest, or, you know, cats have attacked it or whatever. So it's very good and it's very hectic. And luckily today I was doing it, it's kind of like dying down because it's not so much baby season, so.
What's the name of the organization?
North Country Wild Care.
Okay. It made me think of one time we found a rather clobbered turtle and my mom called the hotline like that. The turtle, which was pretty awesome, because you know they get in the middle of the road and people run them over.
Yeah,
you can't even see them sometimes though. If you're in like a truck and the turtle's this big, and you know.
Yeah, you think it's a rock in the road.
Yeah,
so.
Exactly.
And there's as much as we see a lot of animal suffering that goes on out there, there's still a lot of people that do care that will go that extra effort to help out an injured animal.
Tony, I thought you got your license.
I did not get my license.
Oh.
For that, so I failed the test.
Oh, I'm sorry. I wouldn't have brought it up.
No, if anybody's ever interested in becoming a rehabber, it's basically you take an exam through New York State. It's a free exam. It's offered twice a year. The next time it gets offered, which would be in April, I'll sign up for it then. Take it. So that's part of my goal when I retire from work is to do the rehab. Mm. So
that's
right
cool.
Now it's
really cool.
Too tough to do.
What makes the test hard? You have to be able to wrap a wing, like that?
It's actually from what I remember, a lot of it's just it's common sense kind of stuff. Like you find injured animals, what do you wind up doing? It's a 100-question test, and you have to get at least an 80 on it. So it actually doesn't really.
That's pretty high.
Yeah, and it really doesn't. You know, there's really not that many questions on there that kind of deal with like medical stuff. Yeah, it's not very.
It's not math.
No, that's.
Are there a lot of legal questions on there about the law? No.
No. That's why I was kind of surprised with the math, because there's a study guide, and there's like part of the study guide talks about medication dosage.
So were there questions about medication?
No, that's why I was very surprised.
I think there's a test online.
They have a practice.
They do. They do. Yeah. In November, there's also a conference out in Syracuse, New York, which is where the rehabbers kind of get together for the weekend, and there's different, like, training seminars and stuff.
I've been to one.
Yeah, and that's the one thing which I find kind of frustrating with this, is that there's nowhere really to go to learn to do all that stuff.
I was driving up the main turnpike.
I know, but it's tough dealing with the hands.
I was driving up the main turnpike, folks. And here's a woodchuck at the side of the road. Of course, he's dead. But I didn't want him, at least I wanted him to have the peace of dying in the woods. So I went over and I picked him up, and I went down the decline, the incline, or whatever it is, to the fence where the main turnpike property would stop. And I lay him down there, and when I did, he raised his head.
Oh, gosh.
And he looked at me. And then his, he had been terribly wounded, but he was whole. I mean, what I mean. And so, and then he got up very, very slowly and crawled under the fence into his home in the woods. So even though they're in the road, I'd like to stop.
Woodchucks are famous for looking like they're dead when they're not. I check everyone that is not.
Good.
If they're on their back with their feet straight up, they're dead.
Right.
They look like they should be alive. If they're not on their back with their feet straight up, there's a good chance they're still alive.
Yes, that's it's actually happened a couple times, right? Because I ride the motorcycle, so a lot of times I'm always paying attention to the dead animals, because the last thing I want to do is hit, like, a dead animal on the road on my motorcycle, because that can throw me off. So there's been a couple times where I've stopped to move an animal, and it was actually still alive, and just kind of, like, knocked unconscious.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's kind of dangerous, isn't it?
I want Mr. Zimmer to tell us what it's like to be an architect.
It's been a long time. I retired 18 years ago.
Yeah, I remember.
Well, it's very creative, isn't
but
it?
It's a wonderful life. I enjoy every minute of it.
Yeah.
Designing things.
And Barbara Hamilton, tell us about what you do.
I'm just at home. My husband passed away back in December, so I'm just getting used to being by myself.
Well, we'll be with you all the time, anytime. You have our number, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. And Mr.
How long were you married? It would have been 50 years in May.
Wow. 50 years in May. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, a hand up there.
Can I just take a little step back? Because, you know, we were talking about animals.
Mm-hmm.
And a great thing happened just about 2 hours ago. I just came in to our, you know, to back home. And I just took a walk up into the back of our house. And just coming out of the woods was a fox.
Oh, nice.
And he, I'll tell you what a, it must be a great time to be a fox, because he was in fantastic shape. You know, sometimes you see him and they look a little scraggly. This guy was on the top of his game. What a beautiful animal. And he just kind of looked at me and then trotted off back into the woods.
Oh, that reminds me of this morning. I was there's a pond on the property of the apartment where I live, because I live in a house, and I was walking up the driveway and I wasn't paying attention because I was listening to a podcast. So I'm and I hear this noise, and I look up, and there's geese crossing my path, and into the, and I know I have pictures, and into the rest of the yard, and I was like, I was startled. If I hadn't like, you know, woken up a little bit and paid attention, yeah, we've got all the geese there.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's like a whole family.
Oh, yeah. A lot of them.
Now, Sandy Blakeman, tell us what it's like to be a teacher in a Montessori school.
Oh, it's a lot of fun. I teach children who are ages 6 to 9 years old, and that's a great age to be and a great age to be with as a teacher. It's a fun way to go to school, I think, for the children.
Do they do anything funny things, Sandy? Do they make you laugh, I mean?
Yeah, they make me laugh, sure. Yeah.
Probably make you cry, too.
There were a couple that made me cry.
Tammy,
pretty nice.
Tell us what it's like to be a computer expert and make $72,000 a year.
That's a good joke. No, actually, I was a network operations manager when I lived in Florida. I worked for a .com company called iViewIt.com. We worked with Zoom and PAN technology on the internet, patents pending. Also with the Inconia Panoramic 360 views, you know, the realtors are all using that technology now to show their homes and whatnot. And the company that I was working with was a dot-com in the late 90s. And as you know, what happened in like the 2002, 2003, all the dot-coms just burst wide open. So the company picked up and left from Boca and went out to California. I said, no, I'm not going. They said, well, we'll give you a raise. You know, they said, oh, we'll pay you $72,000 a year. I said, no, thank you. I'm not a California person. I like the way that the sun comes up on this side of the continent. So at that point in time, my mother was not well, and my sister was not well either. My sister is currently in a nursing home. She has MS. She's younger than me. And my mother was hospitalized for 6 months in ICU. So I took completely myself out of the workforce and was, you know, concentrating basically on family. In the meantime, the tech world, if you don't keep up on your certifications and everything else, you know, the companies, because I always worked as a consultant and had all my tech training paid for by the companies. So I kind of got out of the tech industry, not actually by choice, but in a sense, I'm glad.
You were needed elsewhere.
Yes, I was, And then I'm trying to start my own company and get into the not-for-profit side of, I don't know exactly how to say what the product is without going into the confidentialities of it, because it hasn't been completely developed, so it's like an invention. So I really don't want to talk about it, but I do need to talk about it if I'm going to get people interested in it. You know, so it's like that catch 22 thing. But I'm going to try to work with schools and communities you know how they used to have the magazine drives and they used to have those kind of things? Well, the product that I have would fit into those kind of categories to build incentives and whatnot for the children at school to, you know, bring these things home. It's not just like the cookie things or whatever, but in a sense it kind of is. You know, so
now
it's
going
one of those things.
Whereabouts do you live?
I live right down here on Elm Street.
Down once a month down at Brown's Brewery in Troy, there's a group that meets. It's a startup group, and they have companies that come there and do presentations about like different products that they want to start and they want to get financing for. The next one, it's coming up this week. You know, if you have nothing, I can give you the details. You can come down and check it out.
Yes, definitely.
They got free food, too.
Yeah, because I'm still working on like the business plan. I filed all the paperwork for the 501(c) and getting all those articles of organizations together and getting those I's dotted and T's crossed.
Yeah, it's kind
stuff.
Of fun, you know, going down and checking this out and seeing some of the different, you know, because there was like one guy, the last time I went, there was one guy, it was like a little, you know, like Staples has that button that says easy or something.
Yeah.
He had a button that was made where, I can't remember what it said, but it was like made for dogs. Like when they had to go to the bathroom, they would go up, they would, you know, get trained, you know, so that when they have to go to the bathroom, go up and hit the light and it would, you know, hit the button actually and it would say something.
Mm-hmm.
So
I'm going
to
go to Debbie.
They had to go.
Debbie and Sarah and Lou and Sam and Gary and Madeline, we're going to after that. And all of you bear in mind that after we watch our video, the Hawaiian Vegetarian Society, keep in mind, what 10 things do you want in life, okay? We're going to go around the table and do that after we see our video. Madeline, will you back it up to Dr. Campbell? That's Dr. Campbell with the wrong one, but it's the video behind this one, honey. I'll tell you one. He's the doctor with the white hair.
You mean just reverse it?
Yeah, just if you could, please. Sarah, what's it like to be
Sally.
In school these days?
Sally.
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 Go ahead.
Oh, Sally?
Yes.
I'm sorry.
That's fine. It's all right, I suppose. I mean, it's the only time that I've ever known to be in school, so I don't really have it to compare to, like, you know, several decades ago.
Mm-hmm. Well, tell us a little bit about it, and it wasn't that long ago for me. It was long enough ago, but...
Well, I mean, it's different as you get to different levels. Like, obviously, when I was younger, it was a lot less stressful than it is now. You know, I play sports all through the, you know, all three seasons. I play soccer in the fall and indoor track in the winter and outdoor track in the spring. Mm-hmm. I'm taking, this year I'm taking molecular biology.
Wow.
Trigonometry. Honors global 10, because I'll be a sophomore. And Spanish 3, and honors English, yeah. So.
Are they nice to you? Are they nice to you at school?
Do you mean teachers?
People nice
or
to you?
Yeah.
Where do you go to school?
I go to Avery Park.
They have molecular biology in 10th grade at Avery Park now?
Yeah.
Oh.
Debbie, tell us what it's like to be a school teacher these
Sam,
days.
How long have you been out of school?
I teach deaf kids in Pittsfield. It's a challenge, you know, I have 3-year-olds through 22-year-olds, and they now have all these rules of things you have to document in a binder of how you do things above and beyond the call of duty to prove that I'm doing my job or something. Mm-hmm. But I just want to say that I also have a business for vegan products for people who want products that don't have animals in them to shampoo their hair or to have protein shakes or vitamins or whatever. So I think that people who are vegan don't realize that their products aren't vegan. And so it's a good business for me because I don't have to worry that there's something hidden in my shampoo that I'm not happy about.
Or it's been tested on animals.
Never tested on animals.
Right.
Because, I mean, you know, so many products today are. And in fact, I think it's something like 97%. If it does not say there are no animals or animal byproducts or tested on animals, then you know it is. And everything out there in the community is
You know what's that. Another simple little way to know if it has been tested on animals, you find out if they sell the product in China. If they sell the product in China, then it's been tested on animals, because that's part of, you know, like a law over there in China that a lot of products have to be animal tested. Mm.
Do you know the Rad Soap Company in Albany?
Excuse me?
The Rad Soap Company in Albany. Most of their line is vegan. They actually just came out with a liquid hemp soap recently. That's like their answer to Dr. Bronner's.
The third one, honey.
It's 65% virgin hemp oil. And you can literally do everything with it. Like, you can wash your car, your hair, your clothes. You can do everything.
Rad
Soap Company. Most of their stuff is vegan. Not all of it. I know they have a couple of products that have beeswax and honey, but most of the rest of their line is completely vegan. And they don't do, like, animal testing or GMOs or anything weird like that.
Nope.
So and what kind of products do you have?
It's everything from brushing your teeth, deodorants, you know, from baby to anti-aging. It's called Arbonne. I don't know if you've heard of it.
Arbonne,
yeah,
sure.
But
mm-hmm.
It's a fantastic company.
Yeah.
And
you work for them. You sell their products.
Yeah. And, you know, I say it's your job to fall in love with the products. It's my job to fit it into your budget, because there's so many different ways to get it at a discount. And I love math. So I love playing with the numbers and making sure that we can get you the best price for it. And it lasts so long that in the end it's cheaper than the stuff you buy at Walmart.
Yeah.
Because it's so pure, you need just a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And people are used to going, you know, because it's a dollar, you know, the dollar store.
And it doesn't work very well.
No, and it's full of chemicals that are going to kill you.
Yeah.
So, you know, to me, it's just the answer.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Gary, tell us about your work.
I work for Avril Park School District. I'm really on the fringes. I don't have a regular classroom. I don't have a regular job. I do home instruction. I do detention. So that's where I fit into the big picture. I'm a very, very small cog. And sometimes I can just take myself out with a picture, which is kind of nice too.
So you would tutor if kids are on medical leave?
Yeah, yeah,
school
I do
or
that too. Yeah.
Tutor
yeah.
Them?
Yeah.
Sam?
Oh.
About your endeavors?
Well, I am a plant-based wellness consultant. I tried to find a plant-based program, and it's almost impossible. So I went with the closest I could get, and it's a school called Bowman College. And you got to take what they dish out with a grain of salt, because some of the stuff that they tout is linked to the Weston A. Price Foundation, and we all Hope we're all familiar with the farce that is the Weston A. Price Foundation, and if we're not, we should go home and look it up and familiarize ourselves with it, because people are going to throw that up in our faces and go, but Weston A. Price says. I try not to speak disparagingly of them, but these are people that are on the butter and, you know, eat lots of animal fat and be healthy train. So that aside, Bowman was pretty good because it was all plant-based and it was much more scientific than some of the other ones. So a lot of the wellness consulting programs are very just kind of super spacey. They don't really talk about the physiology, but there was a lot of that stuff. And so now I'm trying to apply that to help people go vegan and to sustain a plant-based diet. And I do one-on-one consulting. I do in-home cooking classes. I do cooking demos. I do shopping tours. I'll help people clean out their pantries. Basically, whatever people need to be accommodated to a plant-based diet, and if they need help with recipes or whatever, I'll pretty much do it all to support. And I'm going to be teaching a couple of classes in the near future. Actually, next month at Honest Weight Co-op, I'm teaching a, for those of you who weren't here, I'm teaching a raw apple pie making class.
Yeah, we got to go to the
raw apple pie.
Oh, apple pie.
You have to register because there's only 25 seats, but you can do it online. You just go to their website and click events. So that's Honest Weight.
Madeline, tell us about your greatest rescue.
Oh,
Madeline has helped cats tirelessly and dogs.
Well, I can tell you about it now because the dog, it was many years ago, and I'm sure he is deceased at this time. But I used to drive past a dog that literally was tied outside 24 hours a day in a three-sided doghouse on a chain 4 feet long for 5 years. I drove by every day going to work. And I stopped to see the people many times because it was just pitiful. And they insisted that this was the only way this dog was ever going to live. They never wanted him in the house. He was not neutered, so of course he urinated whenever he came in the house. So for 10 years he hadn't been in anywhere but chained on that chain, literally. So one night, after making arrangements with a group that took older dogs, I knew there was going to be an eclipse, and it was the middle of the winter, and it was blizzarding, and I snuck over, and I took him, and I almost got arrested. The sheriff came to my house. The people that took him, the woman lied to her husband and said she didn't know anything about him, and it was just a terribly frightening thing. And then I eventually got him to a rescue group in Massachusetts, and a month later I got a letter from the person that adopted him and some pictures of the dog laying on a couch. And then the fella said to me, I've renamed him Lucky, and he will never be anywhere but in my house till the day he dies.
Oh,
and I'm not proud that I stole the dog. It was a crappy thing to do, but I truly believe it saved his life.
Speaking of what you just said, or what you did, this past week I went down to Socrates. There's a vegan store down there. It's called Healthy Gourmet To Go, and it's a lady who has a business, and she has food that she prepares and she sells to people and stuff. And they're having a fundraiser for a lady named Amber Canavan. She's out from Western New York. She got arrested, I think it was last year, for rescuing two ducks from a factory in Liberty, New York. Because in case you didn't know it, the largest foie gras, if I'm pronouncing it right, is down in Liberty, New York, which I did not know that was the largest in the country. So they have over 100,000 ducks.
Wow.
So I went down last Saturday. It was a fundraiser for her, and she was there, and she kind of talked and everything. And this Wednesday, actually next Wednesday, is her sentencing. She's already did her jail time and fine or whatever. This is sort of like another thing that they're making her go through, where it's like she has to go down there, they do the sentencing and everything. And there's a group of us that are going to be going down. It's a little bit of a drive. It's down Liberty. It's like 2 hours
past
away.
Past Ellenville,
wow.
Right?
Yeah, past Ellenville.
So she got caught stealing two ducks from there? Is that
yes.
What
well, rescuing.
Them, huh?
Rescuing two ducks. Not stealing. Rescuing two ducks. So,
like
and
I see him.
Unfortunately, that's all that she could have carried, she
that's
said.
That's a shame.
So.
Remember, folks, you're going to think about the 10 things that you want. And now, Tony, would you play? This is Dr. Campbell.
Before we go any farther, can I just say that at the moment, if you could, maybe, if you're not interested, ask your friends. I have a 8-year-old purebred chocolate lab male dog named Bear, who is delightful, that we're really trying to find a good home for. Just so you have it in your mind if you know
good
of anybody.
For you, man.
He's 8 years old. He's not a spring chicken, but he's a wonderful dog.
Remember, keep in mind that you're going to tell us the 10 things you want in life. And this is Dr. Campbell, the whole food, plant-based diet, the China study. And he is speaking to the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii.
I don't know where the volume is.
Maybe yeah. This would
yeah,
work.
I think it's from the TV that we're doing.
Oh. It's on the black
Mark Ferguson, CEO and Chief Vegetarian Officer of Down to Earth Organic and Natural, whose generous support has made it possible for the Vegetarian Society of Hawaii to bring Dr. and Mrs. Campbell to Hawaii. To say a few words, Mark?
Internet service tonight. Then last week, thanks, Lorraine. Just when I was driving here tonight, I thought, okay, audio please. Sam, press up the audio there. Vegetarian company. We've had a long partnership with the Vegetarian Society going over many decades. And we're very happy to sponsor Dr. Campbell coming to Hawaii. Thank you all for coming and attending this event. Thank you, and thank you, Dr. Campbell.
Hey, Dr. Campbell.
Ice cream covering in there over there?
Yes, there is.
Thank you, Mark Ferguson. Now, I'd like to invite one of Hawaii's living treasures, Dr. Terry Shintani, to come up to the podium now.
Thank the Vegetarian Society and Down to Earth for allowing me the honor of saying a couple of words about Dr. Campbell. I've known Dr. Campbell since the early 90s, since I learned about his research, which is hailed as the Grand Prix of all nutrition research projects. I've considered him a mentor and a true hero in the field of nutrition, and he's truly legendary. He's been very kind to write the foreword to my new book, which is coming out next month. And now I just want hello, Mai Kako. It's nice to be here. It's nice
okay,
to meet Dr. Campbell in person, one of my heroes.
Sorry about Dr. Campbell.
I wanted to just give a quick legislative update. It's going to take about a minute for those of you that have been here that have been helping with some of the bills we've been working on at the legislature. We've been in contact with the superintendent, Catherine Matioshi, of the Department of Education. I've been working with the Dr. Bill, Lorraine, the leadership of Vegetarian Society to get some plant-based school lunches going here. And I did just see this, and I'd just like to read this one quote. The end of September, I got a letter back from the superintendent saying, and I quote, since our cycle menu fruit and vegetable offerings every day and non-meat protein selections within the cycle menu, we are happy to report that any day of the week can be meatless if a student so desires. This supports the DOE's commitment to offering healthy choices every day in accordance with the USDA meal pattern requirements that dictates the protein portion size and calories appropriate by age group, unquote. In addition to that, Glenna Owens, who's the person in charge of the school food services branch, she has reached out to us just a couple weeks ago and asked to sit down with anyone that's interested in having plant-based school lunches. And so we'll continue to work with them to make this a reality. The second piece of legislation that I introduced last year that actually passed in the Senate, unfortunately it did not pass in the House, would be to require doctors to take some continuing education in nutrition and lifestyle choices.
That's what we need. We need that.
And I think, Dr. Campbell, what they need to do is enroll in your online course through eCornell, but that would be a great idea.
That's a great
and then
course,
finally,
by the way.
I have a short presentation, Dr. Campbell, if you come up here. This is from the Senate honoring and commending Dr. T. Colin Campbell. The Senate of the State of Hawaii hereby honors and commends T. Colin Campbell for his dedicated efforts to improve health and quality of life with plant-based diets. To Hawaii and mahalo for bringing your message of aloha here for the well-being of all. Congratulations.
Here's Dr. Campbell.
Thank you very much, Senator Gabbard, for everything that you've been doing in the legislative field. It's now time to introduce our special guest. We're thrilled tonight to have with us T. Colin Campbell, PhD. Dr. Campbell is the Jacob Gould Sherman Professor Emeritus of Nutritional Biochemistry at Cornell University and the author, with his son and co-author, Thomas Campbell II, MD, of the China Study, the most comprehensive study of nutrition ever conducted, and the startling implications for diet, weight loss, and long-term health, a landmark work which over the past nearly 10 years has launched the whole foods, plant-based diets, and lifestyles of countless people worldwide, and with contributor Howard Jacobson, Whole, Rethinking the Science of Nutrition. He received his training in nutrition, biochemistry, and toxicology at Cornell University, and since 1983, he has been the director of the Nutrition and Cancer Program Project, a collaborative project of Cornell University, the Chinese Academy of Preventive Medicine, the Chinese Academy of Medical Sciences, China Cancer Institute, and the University of Oxford. He has authored over 300 research papers and is the recipient of a number of awards, both in research and citizenship. He is also featured in the well-known film, Forks Over Knives. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Campbell.
Sensitivity to flowers, to fragrance.
That's the Hawaiian thing.
Yeah. I couldn't wear one. Too much.
No.
Thank you so much. I don't know where to start after this reception. This is incredible. I'm really, it's a tremendous pleasure for me to be here to be talking.
Okay. All right, Lou, tell us what it's like to be a ballroom dancer.
I've been doing it for a couple years now. I reached the intermediate stage, and I would say you have to be athletic, you know, to do that kind of dancing, because I've seen people that were, you know, that are overweight try to do that type dance, and you're not in count with the music. You lose, they lose maybe a half a step, and they don't pivot right, they don't swirl right, and you know, I think it's great exercise. It keeps your body moving all the time, and it's a great stress buster. Not that I have really any stress at all, but.
Nice.
They say it's supposed to relieve stress. But, you know, in fact, there's a dance tonight. I don't think I'll go to it. I'm kind of tired.
Do you have to get dressed up? Do you have to wear?
That's optional. It depends on the venue. Like if you're doing a country club, you would have to dress up. But some of these local venues, I'd say perhaps it's like 50-50.
Where's the dance tonight?
It's at the Bomber's Burrito Bar in Troy. It's a swing dance.
I didn't know they did that.
Yeah. Well, it's in Troy.
I know where Bomber's is.
Yeah. They have the upstairs. They have swing dancing tonight.
I didn't know they had the upstairs. I didn't know they did that up there. I drive by there when I go to the farmer's market. It's like right in the corner where I take a turn.
I don't know if I'm going to go tonight because of all the shooting in Troy.
I only go to the farmer's market in Troy, and occasionally I hit the chiropractor, so.
Gary, what are the 10 things you want in life?
Me.
Did you see all the police officers?
Wow. 10?
At the hospital?
Yeah.
Health? Happiness?
10?
Help me out here.
20% there.
Time? Time to, you know, figure out what you want to do. Passion for things, for people. Time to serve, because, you know, serving is a big part of existence. We all served each other and the planet and ourselves. I think the world would be a better place. How many is that?
You need five more, but I think you should talk about the station while you have your floor.
What station? That's
the compression station, whatever the thing is, the fracking in
that's
our neighborhood.
That's the thing that I
Yeah,
we
well, that's
want
one of the things you want in life is to not have it in your backyard.
Yeah.
Right?
Is that going to affect you?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Did
right.
you go to the meeting that they had?
Well, there's a meeting tonight.
Oh,
there's 7.
So we're probably going to leave a little early.
Yeah.
That the last meeting, I didn't go, but a friend of mine went to and I told her, I said, next time they have one, let me know.
Well,
because I wanted to go, that there's a whole bunch of like union guys there too, and they're kind of being belligerent and stuff. Hmm.
Well, at the scoping meeting, a lot of guys from the local laborers union spoke. They want the work, of course, so they came up to the mic and spoke, but they were far outnumbered by the people, citizens who are speaking against and giving reasons why it shouldn't come through. So
there's a meeting going on right now, actually. It's 7 till 9 at Burden Lake.
You could follow us.
Yeah, I thought there was one last night in Skodak.
Mr. Zimmer, 10 things you want.
Or 5.
Well, I'd take his 5.
Those are good.
I'd say peace in the world.
Oh,
I would say I'd like to see the whole world become vegans or at least vegetarians. Let's see, what else? I'd like to see a few honest politicians before I die. That's about all I can think of.
Very good. Sandy Blakeman.
All right. Well, I'd like to be close to God and live a godly life. I'd like to spend time with family and friends. I'd like to put some passion into my teaching and do a good job with that. That's about it, really. That's all I can think of. Had a whole summer spending a lot of time outdoors, so I'd like to be able to continue that year-round, being outside more. That's all. That's only 4, but that's enough.
Who's coming?
To be 10.
Good enough. Sam Houghton.
Well, I second Sandy on being closer to God and then growing in that. And actually, I have to second the thing about serving too, because one of the things that God has been is putting on my heart is you need to serve other people more and you need to show love more, and spreading that love of Christ to other people. And I would also like to see my business get off the ground. And I would like to balance out my health. I mean, going vegan has cleared up a lot of health problems, but I still have 1 or 2 that I'm still working on. So it's how do you find those last few things to tweak to really. And I would like to eventually get to a point where my entire family could be together in one place and in a place where we're all basically healthy and can get along and not have to deal with the winter, because none of us are really terribly fond of that. So I think that's it. You know, I love my family. So,
yeah, where do they live, Sam?
They live about a half an hour from where I live. They live out like in the Sam Lake area. So.
Yeah.
Actually,
where do you live?
I live in North Greenbush. Actually, my mom used to teach right down the street at DP Sullivan. She's like, I don't even know where the Nassau Free Library is. I'm like, Ma, you work right down the street from her. I'm like texting her. I'm like, by the way, Mom, library is like right up the street. I never knew. I can't say anything. I never knew it was here either. I've requested books from here, but I never was here. So.
Did you go to Edville Park?
I went to until 8th grade, and then I homeschooled for high school.
Okay.
Madeline Chapin.
Well, mine is more materialistic sounding. I would like to, and I'm not being funny, I would really like to win the lottery.
Mm.
And I'd like to win the lottery so that I could take
my millions of dollars, which is how you influence people in this world, and I would like to change the laws concerning animals in this country and other countries, but in a direction that doesn't harm animals or anything, or harm people that love animals. It just to protect. Like, I'd like to be able to do away with breeding animals while we're killing them by the millions in shelters. That would be a real direction that I'd like to go in, a moratorium in a law so that we cannot be killing them while we're breeding them. I think that's really important. But also, I would also like to have a beautiful little ranch on 100 acres with a great big fence. So all my cats and dogs that I have, which I have so many of, could run around outside and be happy and not get hit by cars. So it's really not that difficult. Yeah. But I would also like to be healthier. I'm not that healthy, and I'd like to be healthier. That would be something that I would like to be able to accomplish. And I know it's very materialistic, but it's in a good sense. I would do so much for animals if I had money to do it.
That's a money world we live in. And you can't deny the fact that anywhere you go, you need money.
And you know, I've done my little part, but until the laws can be changed, there's only so much people
like
myself can do.
Your little part turns out to be quite a great deal, actually.
In some ways, for the animals that I've helped, it's their whole world.
Yeah.
So, you know, but it's just a little bit. So that's what I'd like to do.
Otherwise, I do 15-minute phone consultations for free.
For free?
Yeah, it's to see. Well, it's to kind of give you an idea of what I do and if it would work. So
okay.
If you're interested, my phone number is on my card.
Okay.
So health is definitely just so important.
Well, folks, the 10 things I want are all rolled up in one thing, and I want us all to realize that God and the universe and helping others is one thing. That's what God is. That's what the universe is helping others. It's living together hand in hand. We do the creating, God, universe, and all of us. We do the operating. It's all ours. It's together. We're here to create and to operate and to enjoy it and pass it on and to love one another. And this is all over. That's what I want. Then I look back and I said, that's what Jesus Christ wanted. That's what Buddha wanted. That's what Isaiah wanted. So we just go on wanting it and waiting. Amen. Tony.
A lot of the things I want have already been said. My main thing would be to be happy and be healthy. I would also want money to have a little sanctuary. Mine would probably be wildlife. So.
We could have a joining 100-acre farm. Yes.
You could run next door for a cup of sugar.
That's why I kind of wish I started a little bit sooner on something like that. So. But that's my retirement goal when I retire.
Very nice, Tony. Barbara Hamilton.
Happiness for my children, good health, peace, and less evil in the world. I don't know if we'll ever see that, but
it seems to be getting worse, doesn't
it?
It is.
Yeah. And to be better tomorrow than I was today, each day be better and better, helping people. And just being a good neighbor.
Good.
Yeah,
that's beautiful, Barbara. Okay. Now we're up to Lou.
Well, I've been retired for 15 years, Department of Labor, accountant. I retired from music, too. 26 years I was in a rock band, bassist in a rock band, and after that, I never went for a master's degree, but I went to vegan culinary school in Princeton, New Jersey for a year.
Oh, wow.
So I got a certification for that.
Nice.
So I don't use the certification because I'm retired, so instead of that, I'm doing dancing instead.
So you're a certified vegan chef?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, and I'm not really using it because I'm retired. I just went there to, like self-improvement, you know.
Let us see the fruits of your training.
Let's bring it on.
Come on.
Come on, Luke. Don't hide it under a basket.
Come on. Shine it up.
I think we've only seen her mistakes so far.
I'll have something next week.
Thank you.
Pretty good stuff. I'm going to give you my card because I write a food blog. Okay.
Why don't you pass your cards out to everybody?
Everybody who wants a card?
Sure. I have one.
Oh, everybody. I think I have one. Okay. I actually have to jet out after this, so if people want to take a card, it's mine.
Well, I'll try to be the first person to actually use 10. So, just, you know, the five that everyone's been saying, you know, happiness, health, love, peace, you know, service to everyone, equality. I think that's really important in the world. You know, there's lots of debates on it now, but, you know, not only in genders or, you know, gay marriage or anything like that, but, you know, it doesn't have to be that centralized. Also, you know, animals, like, obviously not like they're going to be, like, eating next to us on a table, but, you know, just the mutual respect. Like, you know, they look up to us so much, like, you know, my cats were basically all that they've known, you know, were their whole life. And I think the respect really has to be mutual. So, respect is another one. Half that is two. Sorry, let me think.
It was nice to meet everyone.
Oh, it's fun. Nice to meet you all.
Bye.
Sam, thanks. Is it going to take another 2 years?
No, well, I won't. I have to teach my raw pie class at the end of September, so maybe October. Yeah.
See you at the
court. If anyone wants to come to the raw pie class, just go to the Honest Weight website and click on events, and you can sign up.
All right. Thank you.
See you at the court.
Good going, Sam.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye.
Bye, guys.
God be with you, honey.
How many cats do you have?
We have two.
Two.
They've got you full, don't they? You think they're looking up to you?
Oh, you should see them. They're like dogs. Love me. You've been away for 6 weeks.
They're dogs instead of cats. Hunger is a very big problem. And, you know, the amount of food that not only us Americans, but lots of first world, second world countries waste, it's pitiful. It's disgusting. That also kind of goes with the equality that everyone should have the same rights to, you know, have that option to eat healthily. You know, some people can't even eat. We're so lucky to be able to, you know, adjust our diets and have that option. Not necessarily get rid of everyone that's poor, because, you know, we have to have some social things so then we can appreciate where we are, but poverty is a big problem in the world, and, you know, there's some very wealthy people and a lot of very unwealthy people. And then the last one, just general appreciation, because, you know, the world can't go around without being able to appreciate your neighbor and people on the other side of the earth.
And I don't know how I can follow that, except that, you know, my son is in college, and, you know, on paper, you know, growing up and having a life, it's natural and normal, but when they go, your heart is like, oh my gosh, what do you mean he's not going to be here? We haven't had a dishwasher in 3 days, because the three of us apparently don't eat any food compared to my son. So just for the separation of your family and the growing up. And, you know, I guess I must be a little bit on the sensitive side, because I was watering some flowers that my neighbor gave me, And I'm standing there being a typical American saying, hurry up, hurry up. And then I thought, how dare you? You have water running from your house to water plants. Mm-hmm. And there are people on this planet who are thirsty and are dying of no water. And so every time I water my plants, I'm now grateful that I have running water. I mean, we go to the Dominican Republic every February and there's no running water there. And I think, how do these people function? You know, I mean, obviously they're carrying water from somewhere. And now, of course, our community in the Dominican Republic is all being ripped apart because they're trying to get the Haitians out of the country. And some of these people were born in Dominican Republic and have, you know, never been to Haiti. Mm-hmm. And our particular founder of the group that we work with, he had a visa to study and his daughter got a visa to study, but his wife and his son never did. So they're undocumented and right now are faced with them possibly being, you know, deported back to Haiti and ripping the family apart. So, you know, I'm just so grateful for my life that, you know, all of the profits from my Arbonne business goes to the Dominican Republic. And I just want to help people be aware that there are nasties in their products and there are animals. And so, you know, for my gratefulness, I want to share with other people and give them knowledge because I'm a teacher to help the world be better. And I think that if everybody did their little piece, you know, the world would be so much better off. I mean, you see some of the bigwigs now, right? Like Oprah's donating money and whatnot. So I think if that trickles down, like if Oprah can do it, I can do something. And if everybody just did a little bit more this year than they did last year, you know, it can make a tremendous result. So that's what I'm hoping for.
Well, at the World Health Organization, what do I say? yeah, with everybody here, could you imagine the kind of foundation there would be? I mean, it's awesome with what everybody has said. What I got out of most of all this, I hear people being responsible for the planet. And I think that's really important. And I think even, you know, listening to some of the younger input and what, you know, their focuses are today, And it does have to do with peace. Nobody wants to send their troops out to war. My biggest wish is to have all of our troops come home. I'm a former veteran in the United States Air Force, and I really, you know, feel I have, you know, strong patriotic ties. And you know, with the Homeland Security and all the Patriot Act and all the stuff that's going on with the metadata and the spying on the, you know, the phone and the data and that kind of stuff. See. When I was in the Air Force, I worked for NSA. So that was kind of where my niche was, is in the intelligence community. And today, you hear, you know, that there's these conspiracies going on in the world. And you wonder, you know, what part of the government is putting the conspiracies out? Because the way to, you know, to start a conspiracy is to put something that's obviously true out in the public's face. And they look at it and they say, that cannot possibly be true. You know, and that's how they get away with these things. Because I believe in the truth, but they purport the truth and twist it so much that it ends up causing a worse danger than if they just came out and declassified some of the stuff that they have. I'm one of those UFO people. Okay? I mean, I think that our planet has been visited. I really want to go to Roswell. I want to go out there. I want to go to New Mexico. I want to see that.
Extraterrestrial highway.
Yes, I do. I want to.
Get a camper and park there at the end.
You wouldn't leave stud muffin, though, would you?
No. I'll take it with me. That's another thing. I want to be able to travel. I've lived probably more places than I've ever traveled to as far as crossing state borders. And that when I was growing up as a young child, my dad was in insurance. So we moved and we lived in a bunch of different places.
Folks, it's been wonderful. The library closes.
Oh, yeah. Five minutes.
Yeah. Oh, gosh, yes.
We've got to get out of here in 4 minutes.
Yeah.
Did they get a new library?
All right.
New director.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Hey, Tammy.
Yeah.
My nephew is in the Air Force and he works, he's retired Air Force. Uh-huh. And he goes to that place every single day on a helicopter loaded with guns, And he cannot tell us what he does there.
No, I couldn't say anything about what I did until it was declassified. I mean, I couldn't even say that I worked for NSA. They didn't even want anybody to know that.
Take your big and magazine, Tom.
Okay, Louis, is your...
No.
Lenore brought it, okay.
I'll bring something next month.
Oh, I'm leaving. Bring whatever you like. Good.
Lenore, are you able to call?
I've been very busy lately.
Subscribe to your channel.
Yeah.
Thank you, thanks so much, appreciate it.
We're gonna get to this other meeting, Lenore.
I'm not sure if I'm...
We're gonna get to this meeting about the thing, all right?
Well, welcome back, guys, nice meeting you.
Yep.
Very nice meeting you.
Hold then.
Yeah, there you go.
Look at those shoes, Sally, holy smokes, I didn't see your feet.
Trying to break, she's trying to break, man.
Five foot nothing. That hurts me to watch.
You gonna take the pizza?
Yeah, take it home with you, Lou.
Does anybody else want it?
Yeah, take the rest of this good topping in here.
No, I got enough topping.
You sure?
Yeah.
Want some toppings?
Lenore, how are you getting home, honey?
Are we saving these?
I don't know.
I'm not buying the back of my bike. See you next month, Lenore.
See you.
Well, Tony, at least your table lost. I talked to Baby Bunny last week, I'm glad I didn't call you.
Maddie, how is it?
You'd have been like, no, thank you. I'm sorry. Yeah, they are. We don't have to do the tables anymore.
Okay, we could just leave them like this.
Attleboro's.
These tables stay intact, right?
Right, we just hold up the top, I'll take the blocks.
Do you? So I don't try, so would it be inconvenient if I were to ask if you were going, would you be able to pick me up, right?
No. Well, no, because I'm gonna be down there.
You need a hand green stuff out.
Unless you're in Troy.
Oh, no, it's in Troy?
Yeah, it's in Troy.
And what time in the evening is it?
Six, 5:30.
And it's on the night of the week.
I got one, thanks.
I would give you a ride, that wouldn't be a problem, but I work, and then I'm just going straight from Gregory.
So if I couldn't live right, you need a hand to bring stuff out to the car.
We always do.
I'll truck broke down. I'll end it here.
ATTA?
Have you handed it in?
No, everything's right here.
You haven't mailed it in?
No lock? A metal pick.
I didn't know if you wanted it, or if I could give it to you.
Do you have a signer?
If you can send me like a link to what it is, and that's...
Yeah, I just did this one right now, and just send it to you, and then...
Okay, great.
Anyways, I got it.
Here, have a free magazine.
Okay, very good.
Got it?
Yeah, it's interesting, yes.
So I brought this, and I wanted to give it to you.
I know, there's so many things that you can just work on.
Okay, where's your truck?
That you really need to...
Okay, you're gonna drive this stuff home for us, is your choice, pack it up, drive it free.
Because I've already gone to a bank to get financing.
Yeah, I could, sure.
Oh, gee, thank you.
And I'm gonna jump with one dad.
Okay, so now I've had the experience walking in and talking to all of them.
Lenore, you're taking the ice cream, right?
No, I can take that, that's my experience, and think about it.
Gregory's truck is out there.
So just because the first one doesn't work, it's not gonna work.
How are you, Lenore?
Gregory, you're giving her a ride off?
I don't care.
It's not a long time.
Okay.
I missed you too.
All right.
I was wishing you were on the camping trip with us, you would have loved it.
That would be helpful to me, because I am so muffled from all the names. Well, I don't know, driving down the road.
Okay, I don't know which car we're going in.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, Madeline.
Speaking next week.
Who's car are you going in?
This all has to be unloaded.
Whose car are we going in?
Woodstock Animal Sanctuary, this is the grand reopening.
Oh, really?
Yeah, if you're interested in going.
Is he actually in Woodstock?
It's further south. If you're interested in going, I plan on driving now.
Oh, really? When is it?
Saturday.
Yes. All right, well, what do you want carried out?
That's Saturday, yes. I'm going to my brother's, my sister's coming up in North Carolina. Thank you, Tony, I appreciate you asking.
Okay.
And then Sunday I'm going to...
Is this what the ice cream was in?
Not this Saturday.
No.
The Saturday after.
That corn has to go across the street, right, Tammy?
I have to take the cooler.
Yeah, right? There'll be traffic.
Yeah.
They're reopening?
Yes, it's reopening because they moved.
Yes, sure.
From... They're in Willow, New York, which was right outside of Woodstock.
Right.
And they're down south a little bit more. So there's supposed to be another sanctuary opening over in Chattanooga.
I've got it.
Really?
Yeah.
Chatham.
I don't know.
They like some cats.
Yeah, I think it's more farm animals.
Well, they get cats for critter control.
Take what you can out.
When they first opened up, I gave them a cat, and they lost it.
I don't know what car. Your car?
It's a
green truck coming out there.
And they let them out the very next day, and
green truck.
I was so
unhappy. Did you just put it in the back?
Yeah. I guess so, yeah.
I mean, stuff happens, but don't say you're going to confine a cat for 2 weeks if you're not.
I know. Well, it could have been somebody just didn't know.
No, I talked to him. She said, oh, he seems settled.
You like
to
Yep.
What is it, the green truck?
I know.
Yes.
Okay.
All right, Glendora, I got to go before it gets too dark and then
Can you load some
stuff? Well, you don't have cataracts, do you?
No, I had LASIK done a few years ago.
He's on his bike.
Well, LASIK is supposed to correct distance.
Distance, but my night vision isn't as good.
Really?
You know, I get a lot more.
Glendo, this is your breath.
What?
Your breath?
Oh, forget it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
How are we going to get this stuff?
Don't
you see how much is going on already?
Yeah.
Get your camera.
I used to do like in high school and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
My bass teacher is from this area. He's really good. He kind of went out and it's national. He played with, Lenny Kravitz is. He's a rock guy. He played with him for many years. And actually, the last time he was around, he was up in Saratoga. He played up at SPAC with Bon Jovi.
Yeah, Nathan East, I guess, was a good player. Nathan East, Jacob Pistorius.
Jacob Pistorius, that was jazz.